next speaker is, and no negative connotation, but one of the godfathers of respiratory physiology on topics such as atelectasis, ventilation perfusion. It's my great honor to introduce Professor Helen Stierna, a big expert on the topic of ventilation, atelectasis, and more specifically in the obesity. Professor Stierna, will help you.
Thank you for your introduction. Godfather sounds very old-fashioned. I'm not that happy with that. This is the third time I'm visiting you, and I enjoy very much to be here. I think you have the right format for a scientific meeting where you can discuss. And then we have got a very good friendship in addition. Now, you can see on the title that I added age, which may confuse you. But there is obviously so that both age and obesity will influence the lung function during anesthesia. And one of them is unavoidable, and the other one, I don't know. Let me see my face. And then I have to start with an image showing the progress of aging. And the elderly is the fastest growing in the Western countries, with the world population of people over the age of 60 years expected to double through 2 billion per year, or by the year 2050. And over the age of 80, it would increase 26-fold. I'm not at all happy myself to talk about elderly from 60. But I mean, we have all to learn that slowly, whether we like it or not. And then there are some other references illustrating that age is of importance. We have more aged people during anesthesia. And then, of course, we have the previous presenter, Emma, about increasing number of patients who are obese. And I will not say more than you can see on this slide or figure. But both age and obesity have things in common when it comes to the effect on the lung during anesthesia. And that is why I would like to put them together. We have pooled data from 35 years to get larger material, and they form to some extent the basis of this presentation. But we will begin with some basic airway physiology, so that is, I think, perhaps frequently overlooked. But you see in the left panel, or half, a lung during a rather deep expiration. And what happens, and this is a normal phenomenon, I would say that all of you, unless you are around 18 to 20 years old, I keep silent, you will be exposed to something we call airway closure. Airways will close during a deep expiration, even in the most lung healthy subject. This was shown 50 years ago. The first paper was 68. It sounds to be very old, but it's still 1 year younger than my wedding, so you have different perspectives perhaps. But the point is that airway closure means that in the succeeding inspiration, airways may open up again. So there's a cyclic behavior, airways closing, airways opening. If they stay closed, gas will be trapped behind the closed airway and slowly be absorbed into the bloodstream. So atelectasis is caused by gas resorption in most situations, and for sure during anesthesia. Atelectasis is caused by gas resorption in many more situations in the intensive care conditions that we might believe in. The point is that if you breathe air, it takes more than an hour, a couple of hours, to absorb the gas behind the occluded airway. And if you breathe oxygen, or is ventilated with oxygen, it takes a few minutes, 4 or 5 minutes. So pre-oxidation and induction anesthesia causes atelectasis within a few minutes. And I'm not sure that people really are aware that the pre-oxidation and induction are or is the cause of atelectasis. Then it remains throughout anesthesia, even if you continue ventilation with 40%, for example. Why is there such an oxygen dependence? Oxygen is absorbed. It's an important gas for our metabolism. But nitrogen, that is 80% in air, will not be absorbed to a very slow extent. So the nitrogen acts as a scaffold, preventing the alveolus to collapse. Let us see, look at this. I have myself done a bit of work on atelectasis during anesthesia, and I sometimes feel that we, the anesthetist and the intensivist, look at the lung as a black and white image. We have two different things, collapsed or aerated. But I want to emphasize that we have, say, 50 shades of gray, or whatever you call it, in between. And perhaps they are more important than we understand, and in particular in the elderly and in the obese. So if you look at this image, you have to the left a CT scan with atelectasis in the bottom. It's a heart cath, so that's why you see this small Gans catheter in the heart, and a limited amount of atelectasis, rather average. Now, we did a gamma camera study in the same patient. And you see on the right, first in the upper part, what the ventilation and perfusion distributions are from top to bottom. Upright like this, from anterior to posterior in the superposition. And you can see that ventilation and perfusion are increasing down the lung with a fairly similar rate, that the ventilation-perfusion ratio is not far from one, except for the very top where you can have a very little perfusion. If you now go down to the lower panel, showing something that is possibly rather dramatic. If you look at the perfusion, the closed circles, you can see that it increases down the lung as it does in the awake subject. Not much difference. Now look at the open squares, showing the ventilation distribution. And we have most of the ventilation to the upper half of the lung. This is without PEEP, this is a standard anesthesia, zero end expiratory pressure. Most of the ventilation goes to the upper lung part. And it is causing what we call high VQ, high ventilation perfusion ratio. But you measure it as a dead space. But real dead space is not increased during anesthesia. If anything, it will be reduced with intubation of the airway. We will not see much of a change of the real true dead space. But we have regions that are more ventilated than perfused. And as measured as a CO2 dead space, it is a distance. If you go down now, you can see that in the middle we have ventilation decreasing and being less than perfusion. We have a lower VQ area. And in the bottom, we have no ventilation and perfusion still. And the region with no ventilation corresponds to the atelectasis that you see to the left, causing shunt. And above that, we do have in that black area other colors between black and white, the 50 shades, that is low VQ. That is ventilation, but it is reduced because we have intermittent cyclic airway closure. We know a little less about that, if it is just to facilitate our understanding or that we neglect it, I'm not sure. But the point is that this low VQ contributes to impaired oxygenation. I guess it may contribute to inflammation postoperatively in some cases. I would be more interested, having learned some from our studies, to reduce low VQ than shunt. Okay, let us see what happens now with if we go to elder. What does age mean and what does weight mean? And when we go to the next one, it's a little complicated figure, but I go on slowly. On the x-axis, you have age. On the y-axis, lung volume. You have three sloping lines reflecting FRC, the resting lung volume, sitting or standing at the top, supine at the middle, and then with anesthesia at the bottom line. We reduce FRC by lying down by 0.7 liters on an average. We reduce FRC with a further 0.4, 0.5 liters by anesthesia because of loss of muscle tone. So that is unavoidable. Then you have this steeper slanting line, the interrupted closing capacity. That is the lung volume at which airways begin to close during expiration. And you can then see that if you are 20 years old, you are lucky enough to have a closing capacity that is far below FRC even during anesthesia. This means that you will have no or very, very little of shunt. But if you go up and are, say, 45, 50 years, you'll see that already supine, awake, you are close to the lung volume at which airways begin to close. And this, again, is a normal phenomenon. I'm not talking about disease. And if you anesthetize this 45, 50-year-old subject, he will have, or she will have, airways that are closing and opening during anesthesia. Now, if you go to the far right, coming, I'm still on the scale, I'm happy, if you are close to 80 or 70, 80 years old, you see that even standing up or sitting up, breathing awake, you will have intermittent airway closure. So when I'm standing here, I have airway closure. A small amount, but still. Why do I not develop atelectasis? I'm breathing air, I'm moving around, take a deep breath. You can ask yourself, why am I taking a deep breath? Are you nervous, or are there signals asking you to take a breath? I will not discuss it further, but this is a normal thing. The problem is that at my age, between 70 and 80, 77, the anesthetist has to take a liter and a half now and then to open up airways that have closed. Otherwise, I will for sure have a difficulty. Okay, so that what will it look like if I now add obesity or weight? I use the same panel and put in what will happen with the obese, as you know, of course, is that FRC is reduced. So if you go to the lowermost red line, you can see that if you are obese, you will most likely have airway closer, irrespective of age. And if you are old, you can see that a 20-year-old obese subject will have airway closer during anesthesia. 50 for sure, 80 dramatically. Now the anesthetist should inflate my lungs with 2 liters or so now and then. So there is an effect. Now, what does this mean? We have a fall in FRC that causes airway closure, whether we are awake or anesthetized. And then, if we add high inspired oxygen concentration, so that we have oxygen trapped behind the closed airway, then we have gas absorption, and when both are present, atelectasis. I have to emphasize that. The atelectasis during anesthesia, if you stay at the black and white scale, is caused mainly by the pre-oxygenation and induction of anesthesia. So it's man-made, or for sure. Now, more airway closure in the elderly and in the obese, will that cause more atelectasis? It sounds reasonable, and I thought so. Now, we pulled 255 patients that we have studied over a 30-year period. and we fitted different lines to this. And surprisingly, and by far, the most significant correlation between age and atelectasis is a quadratic function showing an increase up to a certain age and then a decrease again. To me, I'm very happy. I'm at the far right, so I had little atelectasis, unexpectedly. Increasing atelectasis from 18 to 50, and then decreasing before the rise in age. We don't have people 100 and so on year old, then they are negative, which is not likely. But we have something that has been cherishing ourselves how to explain this. And I can tell you that our proposed explanation coming soon will be the same for phenomena that we see in the obese patient. First, look at this figure. I seldom have forgotten it almost, but if we induce anesthesia with pre-oxygenation and masked ventilation, so that will be 6 minutes on 100% oxygen, then you see a certain amount of atelectasis, 5.5 square centimeters as an example here. That was 6 minutes pre-oxygenation. If we do mask ventilation without pre-oxygenation, the major thing is that we reduce the pre-oxygenation time or the oxygen breathing time to 3 minutes, and we see a dramatic decrease in atelectasis. And if we are ventilating on a mask and using air, or in this case 30%, we have almost no atelectasis. And we have shown this in other studies, that if you induce anesthesia with 30% of oxygen, then there is almost no atelectasis. And then it will stay non-atelectatic. Now you can say, are we closer during a breath? Slows down both the O2 wash in and the N2 wash out. And that decreases atelectasis formation, because we have more nitrogen there that will keep the alveolus open. So this is an effect similar to shortened oxygen breathing, but another way of doing it. I would say, and I presume, I haven't heard anybody else giving a longer pre-oxygenation breathing to the elderly patient before anesthesia. We all get a minute or three at the most. I guess you can, since my experience goes way back, I shall not say more than that. But this means that if you look at this, you have seen it before, now I point at with the arrow, blue arrow, where a 45, 50 year old patient is. During anesthesia, he or she will have a little of airway closer. Awake already. That is a middle straight line. There you see that even awake, before anesthesia, there is some airway closer. Then we induce anesthesia, and FRC falls down, and you will have more of airway closer. But then, if you look at the numbers here, airway closer during regular breathing, awake, supine from 45 to 50 years. That means slower pre-oxygenation in elderly, but also in obese. Incomplete oxygen wash in and N2 wash out. Less atelectasis. If you would give longer pre-oxygenation, you may perhaps have a safer intubation because you have more oxygen in the alveoli, but you will also have more atelectasis. And you can ask what is best. Now, what is the consequence of atelectasis? Yeah, it causes shunt. The upper panel shows shunt versus age. And again, normally it might look a little less clear, but the amount of shunt correlates strongly to atelectasis. You have a p-value in the left side equation of 0.001. So this figure, shunt, shows that it is being produced by the atelectasis, no surprise. But we have something more. In the lower panel, we have low VQ, and low VQ is caused by our closure. And this low VQ increases with age all the time. So if we put numbers on this and look at the left side, you can see that how much shunt and how much low VQ do you have at 25, 45, 65 years? In the young subject, 2% shunt, 1% low VQ. In the 45-year-old patient, shunt of around 6%, low VQ, 4.6. And in the 65-year-old patient, far younger than me, shunt is 2.4 and low VQ is 8%. And these two phenomena, or we call them that, of course, are impeding oxygenation. So despite that I have less atelectasis, I have a lower PaO during anesthesia because of the low VQ. And I think this is not very well, in fact, this is new for us ourselves. We have just submitted the paper on this. Now you can ask, let me go back to it, what to do? Prevention of atelectasis, a shunt, recruitment, PEEP. In the normal weight subject, I would say 7-8 centimeter water, not more. And how to prevent airway closure? PEEP again will also stabilize airways. And perhaps a slow expiration. And this is a little new thinking. Pursed lips breathing. I don't know how well familiar you are with that. Physiotherapists teach their severely sick COPD patient to breathe out against half-closed lips or mouth. Because that will, most people then believe, well, he, the patient, is increasing airway pressure. But that is not the point. Because the only way to increase airway pressure against against pursed lips is to increase the extra pulmonary pressure. You have to force a little. So that is not the point. The point is that you slow down expiration. And if the expiratory flow is slower, then you need less pressure to bring out the gas. And you move what we call the equal pressure point to the mouth. But anyway, pursed lip breathing or a slow expiration might be of interest to prevent airway closure. And if so, I would presume it be more important in the elderly. And there is papers on the technique FLEX. I have not been using it. I don't know more than I can read in the papers. But you see on the right side that blue curves show how airway pressure during expiration goes down more slowly, how flow is limited during expiration, but volume shall be the same. And they claim that they have a beneficial effect on oxygenation, for example. To me, they have not studied the influence of age, and that is something I would be interested in, and obesity. Now we come to the obese situation, and I have learned that to talk about morbid obesity, so I checked the Cochrane report, and I couldn't really find that you have more complicated different classes, and you know more about this than I do, but I presume that morbid obesity is a BMI above 40, and the normal range is in darker black. Now, if you look at the paper that is from Nestler Hermann Rigge in Leipzig, they show that FRC awake on an average in morbidly obese patients is around 2.4 or 3 or something. That is clearly less than in non-obese patients. So they have this is, you know very well, less FRC awake. Marked decrease during anesthesia on the right side, you see a fall down to something 1.3, 1.4 liters. That's a dramatic decrease. We are starting to discuss FRC levels that you can see in intensive care. But this is during anesthesia. So then they must have more airway closure and more atelectasis. But again, now you see on the right, a similar plot of BMI, actual ecstasy versus BMI in the same material over 255 patients. And again, we were surprised because we had earlier plotted atelectasis versus BMI up to 30, that is below obesity but overweight, and it was a straight linear correlation. Now we add morbidly obese patients up to 54 or something, I don't remember now, and the best fit is again a quadratic function. I will not claim that this is a perfect match. We have put, you can put in a linear regression, but it will be much less significant. We compare different, we divide this into six portions, and then we can see a clear increase up to 30, 35. But above 35, there is no further increase in atelectasis. And if we add a quadratic function, it would suggest that if you are even more obese than shown in this figure, you may have even less atelectasis. So here I'd like to conclude, because I think this is what we have in the world regarding atelectasis with the CT and BMI. There is a limit in the formation of atelectasis in the morbidly obese patient. And again, we suggest that this is the same explanation to it, and that is that the obese patient has airway closer awake. And if you have airway closer awake, you have a more difficult, if you would call it difficult, pre-oxygenation, as with the elderly patient. But there are two aspects. One is that you have difficulties to fill the alveoli with oxygen, whether you are old or obese. On the other hand, or the consequences then, you may have a poorer arterial oxygen tension during a critical period of intubating the airway. On the other hand, you develop less atelectasis, which might also be good. If you look at this figure, you see that PF ratio, the oxygen tension, decreases with increasing BMI. So it suggests that it is not only atelectasis, but airway closure that adds to the worsening of oxygenation also in the obese patient. So if you summarize a little of this, airway closure during regular breathing, awake, supine, is existent, or can be seen from a BMI around 30 kilograms per square meter. That impedes or slows down pre-oxygenation. The incomplete oxygen wash in and to wash out causes less atelectasis, less shunt, but more airway closure. So what to do? Prevent, reduce atelectasis. Recruitment, PEEP. I think that is quite obvious. But then we have the other aspect, prevent, reduce airway closure. Again, PEEP or slow expiration or both. As for the elderly. Look at this study we did 10, 12 years ago it was done. And if you look at patients here, they are divided into three groups. And you can see in the upper row, awake, anesthetized, with PEEP, or then PEEP after 5 and 20 minutes. And you can see that we did a recruitment maneuver up to 55 centimeter of water, 15 seconds I think it was. And then we applied, inspired oxygen concentration of 50%. And you can see that PEEP of 10 does not reduce any atelectasis that has been produced. If we do a bottom line recruitment maneuver and then continue to ventilate with no PEEP, you can see that we have atelectasis during anesthesia, and we do the recruitment, and already 5 minutes later we have most of that atelectasis back. So the recruitment maneuver alone did not help, and we have about 10 patients in each group. If you combine a recruitment maneuver and PEEP, in the middle row, you can see that we do have epileptosis during in the early anesthesia, and then after doing the recruitment and applying a PPAP-10, we can keep the lung open. So recruitment and PEEP seem to be important cornerstones for keeping the lung open. Now you can discuss what PEEP shall you use. This is a study from Gothenburg, Ola Stenqvist and Karin Erlandsson and others. And they used EIT, electric impedance tomography, and found that if they apply a PEEP, in this case 10, they got a downslope indicating the recruitment over these breaths. When they applied a PEEP of 15, they were pretty well level. That is suggesting that you keep the lung fairly well aerated. If you apply a higher PEEP, you can get the upward slope of the relation between lung volume delta Z and the time. So they used a rather simple way of analyzing the PEEP at different levels using electric impedance tomography. You can discuss limitations, and we don't have time to do it right now. But I got some figures from Leipzig, from Hermann Brigge. Now this is an obese patient, obviously. They had one control group limited to 5 centimeters of water, and I must say, honestly, to me it sounds very low. But anyway, they used it. Then they had an intervention group, recruitment, 50, and then down to 30 for 10 breaths. And then they used EIT-based PEEP titration. And the RVD is radial ventilation delay. If you look at this, you can see that if you use EIT, you can measure the aeration and variation in aeration in different lung units. And then you can see during an inspiration how the delay time varies. You see in the, I don't know if you can see here, but, oh, sorry, that was more than I thought of doing. What you can see is that the inflation of the uppermost lung region, you see that on the left panel or square, has the shortest time to reach a peak of inflation. And further down, you need a longer time. And they conclude that they can find the PEEP titration where this delay time is similar all over. That would fit with the ideal PEEP level. Then we go to what did that result in, the same study. And you can see that PEEP that was titrated with this rather advanced technique varied considerably. From 7, 8 something and up to 25 or more, 25 almost. But on the average, I would say that the PEEP that is around 15 would be a rather good guess for most patients. Again, I'm not responsible for what I'm saying. I'm retired, I'm a clinical physiologist, but I say it anyway. And I just ask myself, would I put on an EIT belt? You need some calibration. You have to do this, then analyze it, and then decide 15 minutes later or 20 minutes later that we apply a PEEP of 16, for example. I'm not sure. If I had as a rule of thumb that the patient will survive with the PEEP of 15, I think I'm right. But it's what it shows is a clear interest in how much PEEP shall be applied. There are more things. They followed the patient throughout the anesthesia surgery until after extubation. And the upper part of this figure shows how the EIT titrated PEEP resulted in a larger anesthetic lung volume. Very likely, since the control had a PEEP of 5. If I would have used PEEP of 10 as my control, that we would have done in my hospital, we would be closer. But what is interesting is that apostope, there's no difference. And this is a very important message. And you read in the bottom of the panel, therefore, lung protection strategies should include the post-operative period. They write it in their conclusion. I have said this in different presentations and editorials, and I still do not understand, why is not the anesthetist responsible for a post-operative period? It doesn't need day, hourly visits, but some kind of information, how does the patient do? There are good reasons. This is a study by Lennart Magnusson and Eichenberg. Eisenberger, that was, I presume, when they were, yeah, they're from Switzerland. And you can see that if you look at atelectasis prior to intubation, and I'm not sure that this is really much atelectasis, rather vessels and so on, because I know how they do the analysis. But after extubation, there is much more atelectasis in these patients from 35 kilo. Square meter, and one day later they have even more. So we have a lasting effect on lung aeration after anesthesia. And we have done ourselves a study quite long ago now, about 1992, where we followed I think 15 patients after gallbladder surgery. And you can see in the far left, pre-anesthesia, no atelectasis, anesthesia before surgery, a certain amount of atelectasis. 2 hours after surgery, much more atelectasis. And interestingly, one day later, the same amount. 2 days later, still another. And the fourth day, it's Monday to Friday here, we have less. But we have a lasting effect of atelectasis also in none of these patients. And if there is a difference, it will be more in the obese. What can we do about that? One is, can you keep FRC up by PEEP and CPAP? This is a study by Lennart Edmark that is not published in a very famous journal, but the point is that if you have no CPAP or PEEP after extubation and 20 minutes to 30 minutes after the surgery, we move the patient to the CT scanner. Then one group with no CPAP, PEEP, had more atelectasis than the other group that had a CPAP of 6 centimeters of water. And I think this can be refined, because I know that patients waking up, they don't like CPAP. They're fighting the mask. Leave that to you how to solve it. And then I think I skipped that for the moment, and I'm certainly too much after. So let us suggestions how to improve ventilation from this physiological presentation. And what I did not talk about, but the last figure was CPAP. And continuous dual PEEP during induction is a way of preventing falling FRC. If you prevent falling FRC, you can pre-oxygenate with 100% oxygen, and there will be no atelectasis. I'm sorry that I'm not giving more detail, but we have a number of findings, and including the Swiss group, that also in morbid obese it works. If I were to try to be a pioneer, trying something new, beyond this fancy preventive concept, low tidal volume, recruitment and PEEP, I would look at this. How do you induce anesthesia? If I do induce without this CPAP PEEP, I would use moderate oxygen concentration on induction, 80%. I think many do it anyway, but I mean, because you are not sure how to get 100% oxygen. That will reduce atelectasis to less than one-third of what you get if you are carefully pre-oxygenating. Moderate tidal volume, I have to say that, because it's Adamod, I'm a little cautious, but I would adjust the tidal volume, not to any measured body weight, but I'll see if I am able. That will be the point where tidal volume can have an effect of, in terms of the inflammatory reaction. In elderly then, recruitment, perhaps, low PEEP, yes. Not even no PEEP, but a low PEEP, what is that, 5-6? Why? Yeah, we have less atelectasis. Expiratory flow limitation. I would like to take away the question mark because I think this is something of interest. In obese, recruitment for sure, much more recruitment, 55 centimeter VUs, but there are a lot of different ways of doing that. I wouldn't say impressed, but fascinated by a very complicated way of doing recruitment, step by step, increasing PEEP or and ventilating and then back again. I presume that is to be sure that they are not having a circulatory effect, but or negative circulatory effect. But basically, recruitment is up to a certain pressure, keep it for 15 seconds and then back. High PEEP, yes, I would say 10 we have used, 15 seems to be quite reasonable. And expiratory flow limitation, question mark again. But I would be interested to see that. Then PEEP CPAP during emergence. I think that is something I would really say you shall do it. Because my guess, supervision postoperatively, my guess is that the complications that we still see are to a major extent coming the first 1 or 2 days after surgery, not during surgery. So thank you very much for this.